Hey, everybody. Welcome to Right On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is the show where we talk about all things screenwriting. Today, we have an interview with Matt Lopez, creator of the new show Promised Land.
You and me, we've had our battles. I took the little vineyard your father started and turned it into one of the largest wine producers in the country.
I'm going to buy your company right out from under you.
It's not my company. It's my family's, and no one is taking it away from us.
I'll drink to that.
What is your dream?
I want to be a teacher. Yours?
The house, the vineyard. One day this will all be mine.
I'm so proud of you, V.
Thanks, puppy.
To the new CEO.
Let me guess. Poppy said jump. You said how high?
Just be careful. He doesn't always care who he hurts.
If my father knew you were in here, he would chop you up and use you to fertilize next year's Chardonnay.
Right On's Chardonnay Sellers chatted with Matt about his personal connection to the series, drawing inspiration from classic literature, the importance of maintaining authenticity on the page, and more. Check it out.
Welcome back to Right On, everyone. It's Chardonnay here again with another exciting episode. This time we're diving into the television world, which I love doing because I love watching series like this. I am here with showrunner and creator of Promised Land, the new ABC show, Matt Lopez. Hello, Matt.
Hello, Chardonnay. Pleasure to be here.
It's such a pleasure to finally meet you. But also, I want to thank you for that wonderful letter that your team sent over before the interview today. I thought it was just so, such an icing on top of the cake of the show that I watched.
Oh, that's so nice. Yeah, it just talks a little bit about where the inspiration for the series came from and what I think the lifeblood of the show is.
I've never gotten a letter like that before any of my interviews. So I was like, this is a nice personal touch that makes me really appreciate the show a lot more. But because people obviously don't know what I'm talking about, in the letter, you briefly outline your past. And I'm wondering if you could share a little bit about how you grew up in your family with us before we dive into the show.
Yeah, absolutely. The show, obviously, among the themes that it tackles is immigration, assimilation, what it means to chase the American dream, what it means to achieve the American dream, the costs that are sometimes extracted from us when we try and achieve it or maintain it. I'm a third generation American. I'm Latino, by background. I'm a bit of a Latino mutt, but predominantly Cuban. And it's a very personal project to me in a way that other projects have not been. And in the letter you're referring to, Chardonnay, I spoke of like how what inspired me was the original inspiration came in a very unlikely place, which was Home Depot. And I went to Home Depot to pick up some stuff one day. And there were some day laborers, as you frequently see them out in the parking lot, they're waiting for some foreman to come by in a pickup truck and offer them a day's wage so they can feed their families. And I had this moment of clarity where I thought, my life, because I'm a third generation American who's enjoyed many of the benefits and opportunities of growing up here, my life seems so different from those men who were standing there that day. But the epiphany I had was on a deeper, more meaningful level. The only real difference between me and those men was the passage of time. Mm-hmm. Because those were my grandparents and my great grandparents. They worked in fields and factories. That's where the idea of telling a story set along two timelines came from, like a giving viewers, an audience, a look into an immigrant and American journey at two different places. And what that's done is it's really cool because like another one of the references that I use, Godfather Part Two, you get the best of both worlds. You get kind of the family empire at the height of its power, juxtaposed against the scrappy immigrant story of how the empire came to be. And then and we see, one of the fun things about it is like, oh, wow, we're going to see how these immigrants from these very humble beginnings are going to rise to wealth and power.
That's actually another part about your letter I enjoyed. You are a book nerd. You know your stuff. And I don't get to read as much as I used to, but I too am a literary nerd. And I just wanted to know, like, all of those books that you listed in your letter inspired me. Which is the first one that you got your hands on that you remember, like, oh, this is a part of my DNA?
Dickens was and always has been a really big deal for me. I like to say that Dickens wrote television before there was television. And what I mean by that is, you know, today in 2022, you go to the bookstore or you go to, you know, iBooks or whatever, and it's like, it's a novel, right? It's David Copperfield. It's Great Expectations. But what people sometimes forget is actually many of his great novels were actually written as serialized weeklies. Like, a chapter would appear every week in a serialized weekly that was sold. And so it was very much about the art of keeping readers hooked, keeping readers engaged, like, oh my God, a cliffhanger. So that's what I mean by Dickens wrote TV, you know, 70, 80 years before TV existed. And yet, notwithstanding, he's writing those great twists and turns, those great cliffhangers, in terms of what he's going for like how the richness and the complexity of the characters and of the themes and all that stuff, he's aiming for something much greater. And I'm not going to sit here and compare myself to him. He's maybe the greatest novelist in the English language, but that's kind of what we try and do on Promised Land too, where the show absolutely delivers the goods on the primetime drama. There are twists, there are
turns. Oh, completely. You guys should see my face. My eyes are wide because I can't say what it is, but all I know is I was sitting there watching episode one. And I was 10 minutes in. And I was like, okay, good little family drama. Okay. And then it took a turn. I said, whoa. It was so refreshing to see because you subverted all expectations.
So we very much, you know, we want to play in those waters. I don't hide from the title of being like a primetime drama, but we do try and add this additional layer. And I think it comes through, and I think it separates us from a lot of other, you know, network shows. And Steinbeck was another one, and particularly for Promised Land, East of Eden. You know, somehow in my travels, I had missed East of Eden. I'd read a lot of other Steinbeck, but not that one. And then my daughter had to read it for school.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, let's read it together. And I just got hooked. And kind of along the same lines of what we're talking about with Dickens, it was the same in that if you boiled East of Eden down to a log line, it's like, it's a 10 o'clock drama. It's like, oh my God, there's two brothers and their mother's the town prostitute. And one brother finds out, but is he going to tell the other brother? And there are these two families. And it very much, you know, works as just like a family drama.
Yeah.
But again, in terms of what it's going for, in terms of the characters, it's trying to do something a little bit, I guess, entertain on a couple of different levels is the way I would put it.
Yeah, I made a TikTok about your show yesterday that I'm going to post once this episode airs, because when I tell you those two episodes, I was like, I got, and again, you can't say what happens, but basically, you guys, this show is not the show you think it is. This is a completely different beast in such a beautiful way. And I was in my bed just like yelling at the screen. There's so much happening and everything perfectly comes together in that last episode. So I do want to ask you about that process in a second. But first, I do want to say also, and touching back to your story about Home Depot and immigration, I'm second generation American. My mom is an immigrant. She came here at 7 years old from Belize with seven brothers and sisters. But it was interesting to watch your first timeline with when everyone's trying to get to America, because my grandmother had never told us the story of how they actually got here. And she's passed away now, but we did find a diary entry with a very skimmed outline of how they got there. I don't know if she just never wanted to talk about it, if it was too hard for her. It was interesting watching your show to go, some of our stories are very similar, some are very different.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, look, you and me are sitting here benefiting off of what our grandparents and parents have done before us.
It's a universal thing too. One thing I was really, I'll never forget it, you know, because obviously the characters in the show are Mexican-American. Mm-hmm. But the universality of that experience and that striving and that chasing of the American dream, there was a moment on the pilot where our stunt coordinator came up to me and he was like, I just want to say, like, I'd spoken to him a couple of times, but it was like only maybe the second day on the show. We hadn't even done any stunts yet. And so he was just like, And he got emotional and he was like, I just want to say, like, this is my family story. Like, you are telling it. And I just want to say thank you. And the thing I should say about him is he's Vietnamese American.
Yeah.
And he was like, they didn't come over the wall. They didn't come across the border. They came in a boat. My parents came in a boat, but it's the same, but you tap into that journey no matter what your background is.
Oh yeah. It's the immigrant experience is universal for anyone who's been through it. Like you said, you could be from Vietnam, you can be from Belize, Mexico. And the trick that they do here is they try to trick us that we're all separate, that we all have different. I'm like, no, we're all the same. We just come from different places. My grandmother was an educator in Belize, you know, a professor of sorts, and she got here and cleaned toilets and became a nurse assistant that everyone, you know, basically crapped on. So I agree with your stunt coordinator. It was really touching to watch the show because it made me feel very grateful about where I was. I was like, I'm in my own apartment watching a show about a family. And the only reason I am here is because of what my mom and my grandma did so many years ago. So I just wanted to say thank you for that because it was really touching to watch. But the good times didn't last long because this show, can we talk about this patriarch in the present timeline?
Sure.
I understand him, but I hate him, but I understand him, you know, it's just, again, can't say too much about why I understand him, but this guy is giving me very much, you know, I said in my reel, in my TikTok, and it may be like a watered down comparison, but it's giving me Succession in Wine Country. I was like, there's a lot of family dynamics going here. And this patriarch is the head of it all. And I cannot wait to deliciously see how he makes decisions because I know it's going to be awful, but it's going to be so good for me as a viewer.
Right.
I want to know to Matt Lopez, the creator and showrunner, who is this patriarch? Like, who is this dad?
It's really interesting because in a very early iteration of the show, he was going to either, there was a version I was working on where in the first episode, he would either have just died or he would die in the first episode. And it would be very much about Letty, his wife, and the family, like, recovering from that. And then I'm not sure exactly when I decided like to keep him around, but I am really glad I did. I mean, because he's so brilliantly portrayed by John Ortiz, who's just a great actor's actor. Just, you know, John Ortiz may not be like a household name. He's the guy but you'll see him on TV and you're like, oh my God, that guy, you know, he's in Silver Linings Playbook. And he's in Miami Vice, the movie, and he's in a couple of Fast and Furious movies and just brilliant, brilliant actor. It's complicated. You know, what I like about the family dynamic is each of his kids you see has a facet of his personality, like seems to be dominant, right? So his son, Antonio, it's like, that's the ambition. His daughter, Veronica, is like the vision, you know, his daughter, Carmen, you know, you see, it's kind of like the dreamer. To know that character better, we'll see, like, she's underestimated right now, but you kind of underestimate her at your own risk. She has very, very big dreams. So, you know, you see all of those facets reflected in him, and he is a little bit of a master of pulling strings with his
little.
he is. He's not quite, I would say, it's funny you say, because I have a friend who's a producer who his nickname for the show is Sonoma Succession. That's what he calls it.
Sonoma Succession.
It definitely has some of those Succession vibes. Now, Succession is it's brilliant. It's an amazing show. It's a little bit different. I would say it's a different vibe in the sense of, like, Succession is very much a show for the head, and Promised Land is too, but I think it is also in a way that Succession is not, a show for the heart. And one thing we'll see about the Sandovals, and because I very much wanted this to feel like a real family, is yes, like a Succession, there are sibling rivalries. There are brothers and sisters who are going to do not very nice things to their brothers and sisters. Mm-hmm. But there are also moments where you see like every family, I think, can relate to this. It's like, I can be really mad at my brother, but the moment, like, we're both threatened from something outside the family, you circle the wagons, you pull up the drawbridge, and it's like, wait a minute, I get to beat up my brother, but you don't get to beat up my brother. You know?
Yes. No, and I think that's an important distinction from Succession, because on your show, even though this patriarchy, guys, he is, I don't want to call him maniacal, but he has some plans. I can really tell that he genuinely loves his family and he loves his business. And sometimes those clash, but he really does want everyone in his family, you know, to do well, unlike some of the people on Succession. I don't think he really likes his kids. But
That's I talk a lot about The Godfather was an inspiration for this. And if you think of Brando in the first movie or Pacino in the second movie, it's like they care deeply about their families, very deeply. And yet the distance between like their ideals and then when it actually came to dealing with their family and how they dealt with their children.
We won't give it away, but that pool scene pissed me off. I was shocked.
It's rough.
I don't know how Letty did it, because I would have stabbed somebody. She's better than me. But he's definitely an anti-hero that I'm looking forward to watching for the rest of the season. He brings a dynamic. They all do. I want to go back, if you can, to the writer's room and what it was like for you, you know, building that room and what that felt like and how you made the decisions for the writers that you were going to have.
It was a great experience. And the room today, they're not here today, but today happens to be the official last day of the writer's room.
Oh,
and I know it's like kind of bittersweet. So, but it's a fantastic group. It was a pretty small group. I did that intentionally. We had a very aggressive production and post-production schedule. I made the conscious choice up front to have a smaller but more senior room. So we only had basically one writer below the position of supervising producer.
Okay.
And so we had, you know, people who had been on sets, people who had produced shows and who had that muscle. Other than that, you know, I think when I staff, the most important thing I'm looking for is a voice, really. I'm less concerned with that their sample or the shows that they've worked on be in the same realm or the same key as this, as whatever show I'm running at the time, because I feel pretty confident, like I can teach people the voice of the show. I as the kind of creative patriarch, if you will, the scripts will get into the voice and get into the vibe of the show.
Yeah.
And so I'm less concerned with that. And in fact, now that I think about it, on Promised Land, had a couple of writers who had never written a serialized drama, who were more like procedural type writers. Had a half hour comedy writer who really, I think, maybe had worked on one other drama, but not a ton of drama experience. But there was something in her sample. She was a first generation Mexican American. And I was like, she gets this in her bones. Like she understands like this experience and will give a level of authenticity and keeping it real that the show, you know, needs and wants, you know, and then it's got to be there on the page. And then personal touch is a big deal for me, interviews, because, you know, you, it's these TV rooms, these are people you're going to spend a lot of time with.
Yeah.
And there's an alchemy to these rooms that a showrunner, you know, you have to be the guardian of, you know, it's like you're putting together a basketball team. You can't have five centers or five.
Yeah. You know, yeah, you that's guards, a good analogy.
You know, you need guards, you need centers, you know, so like this room, there are a couple of big personalities in the room and they make the room better, but you can't have five big personalities, you know, that's gotta be balanced by other types of folks. And so, you know, and I'm kind of the ringmaster of the circus, I guess you would say.
And for anyone who doesn't get sports analogies, think shoes. You need loafers, sandals, sneakers,
correct,
boots. There you go. Just helping other people out. I want to ask, because a show like this, like you said, you mentioned you have a writer who's first generation Mexican-American. It must get so personal having to talk about experiences. Like, I just talked about my grandmother's, but I want to know, like, what was that like in the room? I'm sure there were maybe some awkward moments of tears, or I'm guessing, but I
there,
would
cry. there was a lot of, I've never been in a room so much where like a story pitch would begin with words like, okay, one time my cousin ... or yeah. One time my mom ... where, you know, we were really pulling from our personal experiences. There's kind of this beautiful moment in episode 3, and the writer of that episode was on set with me, and she had pulled this, not the particulars, but kind of the overall thrust of the scene. She had pulled from something she experienced as a child. And we were at lunch on the day that we were shooting it, and she burst into tears. She just got very, very emotional and very overwhelmed, because it's a really, really gorgeous moment in the past timeline in the show. And that personal connection, I think, really made the show and makes the show very rich. And it's the same with the cast. I've never worked with a cast that was so invested. You know, they're used to being oftentimes, you know, it's a largely Latino cast. And so I think they're used to being like, I'm the Latino character in this show over here, or in that movie over there. This is the first time where it's like, oh, we're all coming from this wellspring of shared experience and culture. And even though the show has this universal appeal and tackles these themes that are almost Shakespearean, they're so timeless, the specificity of that family and those emotions, I think it comes across the screen. Like, I think there's a lot of moments, some of the moments that I respond to the most, I'm like in the edit now in episode 6, you know, will be just, you know, seeing like 4 siblings together around the kitchen table, like, and it feels so real. And the actors, you know, and I feel so fortunate, like they had that from the word go. Like I look back, I took a bunch of pictures on the first night, you know, we met for drinks. I got the whole cast together, and I look at those pictures. I saw them recently, and we had just met like that night. But if you looked at those pictures, you'd be like, oh, these are people who have been friends for 10 years.
Yeah.
And it just gelled like that.
Well, there's a bond, a friendship, a kinship there, because I mean, look, we had In the Heights, we have Encanto, and now we've got your show. It's been a good year, right? It's not a great year, but it's been a better year. I do want to ask you, we have a mutual friend, Sonia G. Hi, Sonia. Prima, who was singing your praises on Twitter, and I saw it, and I haven't told her yet that I was doing this interview, but do you understand the gravity of your show and what it means to people that come from backgrounds like you and I? And again, I'm not even just talking about Latinos, I'm talking about immigrants or people of color anywhere. Does that ever seep into your mind to know that we are doing something? Like you said, the cast are usually, you know, auditioning for roles as the other, and now this is like a centralized home.
There have been a few moments it snuck up on me. I mean, the casting process is really where it started to hit home, where I was like, oh, this show could really strike a chord with people, where we would have actors come in to read for parts and say they would read for the past timeline part. And they, you know, the take would be over, and on their way out, they would stop me and they'd be like, my parents picked strawberries in Santa Paula. I've never seen their story on television, you know, like, thank you. You know, it's not strawberries, it's a vineyard, but same idea. But then we'd see the other extreme too. We'd see like Latino actors come in, and on their way out the door, they would be like, thank you for showing an extremely wealthy, unapologetically successful Latino family that's not in the cartel.
Yes, exactly.
And it's true, you know, you'd see these, you know, you're seeing these actors, you check out their IMDb page, and it's some of them, it's cartel, cartel, cartel.
Yeah.
I very much, you know, I didn't want to do that. There were, you know, writers who I interviewed with who wanted to staff on the show in the staffing process. And, you know, sometimes they pitch me ideas and stuff. And if there was anything that ever started with, what if, you know, the Sandovals, yes, they're a vineyard, but there's also a secret money laundering operation, or there's also a secret drug deal, I'd be like, we're not going to go there. That's not to say, look, Joe Sandoval, the patriarch, as you say, like he has some very sharp elbows. Like he clawed his way to the top. And, you know,
which I am excited to watch unravel because we got a tease of it from his ex-wife. And I was like, oh, what did you do? Very excited.
So you see, you know, it's not, we're not going to like paint them, you know, we're not going to sugarcoat them, but I do want to, I challenge the writers on the first day, like, let's just try and stay away from those tropes we've seen.
Tropes. Before. Yeah.
And so I guess, you know, it's on our mind, but then you also have to forget about it. You know, like we had a director come in who directed episode 4, which is great. And he was like, you know, a very, very experienced television director, Latino, who has been doing it for a long time. And he's like, you know, these chances for these shows to get on the air, they're few and far between. So he was like, you know, every script has to be a gem, like every, like, because if you fail, if you screw this up, basically, like, it'll make it that much harder for the next Latino show. And on the one hand, I took it to heart, and it was very meaningful and kind of emotional when he said it to me. I related to the writer staff, and they were similarly moved by it. And then I said, like, and now we have to forget that, because at the end of the day, we have to focus on telling a compelling story and focus on the characters and focus on the story. And if we worry too much about what is the, you know, what impact is this show going to have, et cetera, like, that'll take care of itself. Like, just the mere fact that people are going to tune in and see these characters on this journey, we don't have to get on a soapbox about it. Let's tell a good story and let's entertain people.
Yeah. Cause it's also unfair that that only happens for people of color, where we take on the entire community's success and failures. And that is bullshit. So.
Yeah. The cast, when we were waiting to get picked up to series, they wrote this letter unsolicited by me. They wrote a letter to the network just saying, because there were so many Latinos in the cast, what they felt it did is exactly what you're talking about. It relieved them of the burden of representation. So that it's like, you know, because those are the two extremes, right? Latinos, oftentimes you're either in the cartel, or there's a kind of softer, well-intended bias that happens, but it's still a bias, which is, and I've experienced it, where it's like, oh, there's one Latino character. Let's not make him bad because there's only one. And so we don't want to be seen as we're making a statement that a Latino character is bad. So it's coming from like a place of generosity, but that's in its own way is problematic. And what we try and do is like portray people in all their messiness.
Yes.
Exactly. And all their richness. There are moments of grace. There are moments of what's the opposite of grace. I don't know. Like selfishness, you name it, you know, they're just real people. They're messy.
And I think that's very true. Showing that obviously that community is not a monolith. There are very different, many different versions, you know. I think that's important. I have a pitch for you before I ask you my last question, casting wise, take it or leave it. But I'm a huge fan of Michael Pena. And I personally believe that he has been shortchanged on roles since he started. I don't know, season 2 villain or hero, put him on the show. I just know he would do well.
He's so good. He's one of those actors. He actually reminds me a little of John Ortiz, because John is one of those guys, like, one of the reasons, you know, he's a chameleon. The guy can do anything. You see him in Silver Linings Playbook. He's Bradley Cooper's brother-in-law. He's sweet. He's funny. You're just laughing.
So good.
And you see him like in Michael Mann, the feature version of Miami Vice. And for my money, he's the best thing in that movie. And he will scare the bejesus out of you. It's like, please never let me meet this person. And he talked about, you know, at the TCAs, they asked him a question and he said, I got emotional. He had never told this to me before. He said, you know, this guy's a working actor, a New York City theater legend for 30 years. And he said, Promised Land is not the first lead role he's ever gotten. It's the first lead role he's ever been offered. And so those opportunities, you know, they are often, you know, and Michael gets like a lot of those great supporting roles, but the leading roles are tougher. They just are.
And it makes no sense because he's so talented. For years, I've been like, put him in the lead. Why isn't he leading a franchise? Why isn't he leading a movie? Why isn't he on a TV show? Why? Because I just love him. If I ever meet that man, it's over for everyone. I have one last question for you, Matt, because you're busy and I know you have to go. What advice do you have for your younger writer self, since we are a screenwriting podcast? You know, if you're in your early days of writing.
I would say the most frequent advice I give to writers is, you know, if you haven't already developed a thick skin, develop one. You know, there's a lot of rejection. The barriers to entry in screenwriting, television writing, they're extremely high and it can be hard to bust in. But if you keep working and keep at it, I do believe eventually your talent will get recognized. It's just in the meantime, can you withstand the body blows, you know, because it took me 10 years, you know. I had a completely other career. I was a mergers and acquisitions lawyer. I was a corporate lawyer in a law firm. And then I was a business affairs executive at DreamWorks back in the day when DreamWorks, you know, like I worked on Saving Private Ryan and Gladiator.
Oh, wow.
But as a lawyer, and it took me a long time to like break over to the creative side. But, you know, if you love the work, which I do, that's my favorite thing is just sitting alone in a room and writing, then you'll develop that discipline and that work ethic. You know, I think that's got to be there. There's very few writers that I know. I know one guy, my friend Lloyd, who sold the very first thing he wrote. And I'm like, I hate you, Lloyd. I wrote 7 feature length scripts before I sold one.
Yeah.
You know? And it just, for me, it took a while. And for most people I know, it takes a while.
I love that. And then that's a big theme of your show too, which is discipline. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad. Matt, it's been such a pleasure to talk with you. Promised Land, you guys, has already started airing on ABC, and you can actually watch the first 2 episodes on Hulu if you go right now. And after that, it will be Mondays at 10 p.m. on ABC and then Hulu, I believe, the next day or at the same time. I'm not quite sure how that works. Same time and next day.
Correct.
Right. Cool. Cool. So please sit down with your families and watch it, especially go watch these first 2 episodes. I'm telling you, after the first 10 minutes of that pilot, you will be like, what show is this? What am I watching? No one warned me about it. And I can't wait till we cut so I could actually say it out loud, because I was like, whoa, what's happening? I look forward to meeting you again at some time in the future. Stick around. Don't hang up. Everyone else, I'll see you next time on the show.
Thanks, Chardin.
Thanks to Matt Lopez for coming on the show. Promised Land can be streamed on Hulu right now. And as always, thanks to you, our listeners. If you liked this episode, leave us a review. And if you haven't already, subscribe to the show on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This podcast was produced by Kayla Guess and co-produced by Emma Vranich. Editing is by Sean Bonnet. Music is by T. Kelly. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, right on.